Recordings will be played once only. The test is in four sections. Section 1. You will hear a new student on a short summer course getting information from the college receptionist. First, you have some time to look at questions 1 to 5. You will see that there is an example which has been done for you. On this occasion only, the conversation relating to this will be played first.
Sorry to keep you waiting. OK, here's the information you need. On the first page, there's some info about the college, the facilities, the courses on offer, etc.
Uh-huh.
Then, on these blue pages here, there's an outline of the social activities. You see there, OK?
Yes.
Now, this part of the booklet here, the yellow pages, that's the main program, starting at 9 a.m. tomorrow.
9 a.m, OK.
The receptionist says that the program begins at 9 a.m. So 9 a.m. is the answer. Now the test will begin. You should answer the questions as you listen, as you will not hear the recording a second time. Listen carefully to the first part of the conversation and answer questions 1 to 5.
Sorry to keep you waiting. Okay, here's the information you need. On the first page, there's some info about the college, the facilities, the courses on offer, etc.
Uh-huh.
Then, on these blue pages here, there's an outline of the social activities. You see there, okay?
Yes.
Now, this part of the booklet here, the yellow pages, that's the main program, starting at 9 a.m. tomorrow.
9 a.m, okay.
So all the new students will be gathering in Herville Hall at 9 o'clock.
Sorry, where?
Herville Hall. I'll spell it for you. It's H-E-R-V-I-L-L and then H-A-L-L for Hall, of course. It's the big white building by the entrance.
Okay, I've seen it.
Right. Anyway, you'll be in there for an hour. First, the Director of Studies will explain the various courses we offer and the requirements for them. Then for the second half hour, the social organiser will tell you more about the social program and Saturday excursions. Is that all clear?
Yes, I think so. Then where do I go after that?
Ah, yes, okay. After the talks in the hall, there's a break. And then at 10:45, go to classroom 4 to have a placement test.
10:45. This placement test is to find my level in English?
Exactly. Then, after the test, all the new students are invited to a special welcome lunch.
In the cafeteria?
No, no. Not for the welcome lunch. It's in a restaurant near the school. An Indian restaurant.
Oh, okay. I don't think I've ever tried Indian food.
Do you like spicy food?
Yes, I do.
Then you'll love Indian.
Before you hear the rest of the conversation, you have some time to look at questions 6 to 10. Now listen and answer questions 6 to 10.
So, where's the Indian restaurant?
Don't worry, it's really easy to find. Have you got that map I gave you?
This one?
Yes, that's it. See here, the main entrance to the school? Yes?
Mm-hmm.
Well, don't go out of there.
Oh.
There's a smaller entrance here, round the back.
Oh, yes, I see.
OK, so you go out of there, past the phone box, and then turn right into this road here, the one that goes along the side of the park.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see a supermarket on the left, and then it's just after that on the right.
Uh-huh.
It's quite a big place. You can't miss it.
Okay. Add one more thing. Is there a post office near here?
Post office? Oh, yes, of course. Just the other side of the park. Go through the middle of the park, and it's there by the park entrance.
Thanks a lot.
You're welcome. Oh, there's a good cafe near here too. Very popular with the students. Just there. You go out of the main entrance into Varley Road, then turn left at the bank, and it's at the end of the street. They do amazing coffee.
That's great. Thanks very much.
No problem. Enjoy your course.
Thanks again. Bye.
That is the end of section one. You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now turn to section two. Section two. You will now listen to a talk on bicycles. First, you have some time to look at questions 11 to 20. Now listen carefully and answer questions 11 to 20. Today, we're going to talk about the latest bikes for professionals and novices. There's something to suit everyone from price to function. The Atlantis is a touring frame. It's also perfect for commuting and trail riding, and anything short of super fast road riding. The tubes are stout, to take touring loads and trail abuses. The tyre clearances are majestic, so you can fit tyres up to 2.35 inches. It's designed for cantilevers or V-brakes. If you have to limit yourself to just one bike and you want to be able to ride just about anywhere, this is the bike to be on. It is our most popular model for just that reason, and there isn't an unhappy Atlantis owner in the land. The Rambouillet, our all-around road bike, is available either as a frame with fork and headset for $1,400 or as a complete bike for $2,300. Compared to the Atlantis, it is a lighter frame, not intended for loaded touring or rough trail riding. As a road bike, it has side pull brakes. The Quick Beam is our version of the single speed bike. We've done it a little better though. The crankset has a 42-34 combination, running an 18-toothed freewheel cog in the rear. And the rear hub is threaded opposite the drive side, so you can install a fixed cog of your own choice. In essence, you can have four speeds on the Quick Beam if you choose. The Quick Beam is available as a frame with fork and headset for $900, or as a complete bike for $1,300. This is a rugged, versatile bike that you can ride on the road as well as on rough trail. The Saluki is our roadish, light touring, randonneuring frame. It's designed for 650B wheels. If 650B means anything to you, you'll either love it or think it's marketing suicide. If you're new to 650B and a follower, you won't want it. If you're new and a rebel, you will. Now, I'll just talk a little about saddle comfort. The road bike, for the most part, has turned into a high-tech, uncomfortable machine, and the proof is all around us. Look through any bike magazine or catalogue, and you'll see the saddle up to 6 inches higher than the handlebars. It is impossible to be comfortable on such a bike. It forces you to lean forward, putting more weight on your groin, hands and arms. People ride these bikes with straight, locked-out arms and wake up with aching backs. They endure it, get used to it, or buy recumbents. When we custom design a bike for you, you'll be able to get a comfortable position. Your back will be between 45 and 50 degrees, and there will be a noticeable bend in the arms. And most importantly, your arms won't be supporting your body weight. You won't have to look up to look ahead, because you won't be hunched over and low. That means our bikes are more accessible for riding on the flats, or even for short climbs. We consider this when we design and build your custom frame. That is the end of section two. You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now turn to Section 3. Section 3. You'll hear an admissions tutor at a university interviewing a prospective student. First, you have some time to look at questions 21 to 26. Now listen carefully and answer questions 21 to 26.
Hello there, it's Robert Johnson, isn't it?
Yes, that's right.
First of all, thanks for coming to this interview and thanks for applying to the Engineering Department of Wesley University. This is a fairly informal interview where I just get to know you and find out what kind of person you are. There won't be any technical questions as we've got all your educational background from your application form.
Oh, that's good.
Now, I know you've applied to us to study civil engineering, so can you tell me why you chose this field?
It's a mixture of reasons, really. First of all, I've always been fascinated by building things. Whenever the family was on the holiday, I would always be interested in the local bridge and all that. My father is a civil engineer too, so he'd always be able to explain things. And it was he, I suppose, who really fostered my interest. I'm lucky as well, because my best subjects at school were maths and physics, which are the ones that are particularly used for engineering.
So you'll be keeping it in the family then?
Yes, my brother wants to do the same thing as well, so you'll probably get an application from him in another 2 years.
Great. Now then, I noticed from your application form that you took a year off between school and university. What did you do during this year?
Well, I'd like to say I got plenty of work experience, but what I did was travel. I went to Australia for the year and spent the time travelling and working all around the country. At the end, I went to New Zealand and travelled around there for a couple of months.
What kind of work did you do out there?
It was fairly menial stuff. I delivered furniture, worked in a pub, worked in a hotel, and worked on a building site for a couple of months too.
Working on a building site must have been a good experience for engineering.
I suppose so. I mean, it was interesting to see the brass tack side of things, and a good engineer has to get his hands dirty, my father says.
He's absolutely right as well. Now, why did you choose Wesley University to study civil engineering?
Well, first of all, I know that the department has a very good reputation in this field. And before applying, I checked out the stats and saw the percentage of graduates going straight into industry was very good.
Yes, we're very proud of that.
I'm also very interested in mountaineering, and your campus here in the Midlands is within reasonable distance of Snowdonia, so I'll be able to go hiking at weekends when work allows.
That's good. It's very important for students to have interests outside of their studies. It helps deal with the stress.
I also play a lot of football, and the university runs quite a few teams in the local leagues, so I'd like to get into that.
You now have some time to look at questions 27 to 30. Now listen to the rest of the interview and answer questions 27 to 30.
Is there anything you'd like to ask me about the course?
Yes, the information in the prospectus wasn't very clear about assessment.
How will I be assessed over the 4 years of the course?
Well, as it's a sandwich course, you'll be working in industry for the third year, and there won't be any exams for that year. In the first year, you'll have exams at the end of May. You'll probably have 5 papers to sit then. The second year is identical to the first year. You have to pass the exams in these years, but they won't actually be part of your degree. In the fourth year, you'll have to write a dissertation of a minimum of 15,000 words, and most people use their time in the third year, when they're working, to use as a basis for their dissertation. So the third year can be spent doing the hard work for the dissertation, leaving the fourth year to polish it and study for your finals.
What will I have to do for the finals?
There will be 8 papers in all during June, and these will be based on work done throughout the entire course. It's hard and a stressful time, but students usually cope with it. Anything else?
Yes, I'd like to ask.
That is the end of section 3. You will now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now turn to section 4 of your listening question booklet. Section 4. You will hear an introductory lecture about vegetarianism being given by a nutritionist. First, look at questions 31 to 40. Now listen to the lecture and answer questions 31 to 40.
You will all have a vague understanding of what being a vegetarian is all about. Vegetarianism has been practiced for thousands of years. The simplest definition is someone who doesn't eat meat, of course. But does abstaining from eating meat include seafood and chicken? The fact of the matter is that people adopt the label vegetarian but still eat meat, at least to varying degrees. Within true vegetarianism, that is where a vegetarian is someone who doesn't eat any meat at all, there are 3 subgroups. A lacto-ovo vegetarian eats no meat but does consume dairy products and eggs. The second subgroup, lacto-vegetarians, also don't eat meat, but while they will consume dairy products, they don't eat eggs. And then, of course, there are vegans, people with a strict vegetarian diet that don't eat any animal product or byproduct, including honey. In fact, they don't even wear woolen, leather, or silk garments. So just keep in mind that there is an obvious sliding scale here when people talk about vegetarianism. There are those that perhaps like to think of themselves as vegetarian just because they don't eat red meat, right through to those strict vegans who will only eat vegetables, fruit, beans, or pulses. That is, food that has been grown. For our purposes today, we'll be talking about vegetarians as those people who don't eat any form of meat at all, red meat, fish, or poultry, but do use dairy products and eggs. Lacto-vegetarians and vegans are not in the majority anyway. With that definition in mind, let's review the myriad of reasons given for adopting a vegetarian diet. These include all sorts of preposterous theories that claim all humans should be vegetarian simply because it's natural, or that humans are naturally vegetarian because biologically we resemble plant eaters. In the real world, Vegetarians, generally speaking, accept that humans are omnivores. They are capable of eating both plant and meat foods. Statistics show that the majority of vegetarians have adopted a vegetarian diet because of their religious beliefs, as in the case of Hindus and Buddhists, for example, or because of health-related concerns. That is, they see vegetarianism as a healthier alternative. Look, that's not to say there aren't other reasons. Some people just don't like the taste of meat, and others simply can't afford to buy it. A significant number of vegetarians are animal liberationists who are against the killing of animals for human consumption. These vegetarians have taken the step of refusing to eat meat, and in doing so, show that they don't condone those killings. They see the whole industry as barbaric. In the past, at least in my social circle, such a cause was seen as noble, and many of us held vegetarians in high regard. They lived up to their beliefs. In more recent times, as we see the disastrous impact of introduced hooved animals on lands and the amount of resources used to feed stock at the expense of using arable land for crops, their noble cause has been ecologically justified as well. Land resources, and arable lands in particular, are scarce and becoming scarcer. Perhaps it is wrong to allocate these resources to raising those animals which provide us with a food source that we can live without. But is this the case? Can we live without meat in our diet? And is living a vegetarian lifestyle indeed more healthy as advocates would have us believe? Vegetarians claim that a well-balanced vegetarian diet will supply all the essential nutrients we need to be healthy. In Western societies, as late as 20 or 30 years ago, there were many myths about vegetarianism. Those switching to vegetarianism would be warned about serious vitamin deficiencies. Statistically, though, the vegetarians are supported in their claim that vegetarians are healthier than meat eaters. The incidence of heart disease and cancer, for example, are significantly lower in non-meat eaters. In fact, it's claimed that the risks from certain cancers are reduced by up to 40% in a vegetarian diet. And let's face it, in modern Western society, with our concerns regarding obesity, you don't see too many overweight vegetarians, do you? Vegetarians consume less fat and protein than we do, and the fat that they do consume is in the main unsaturated, which is what has been recently labelled good fat. On the other hand, animal fats tend to be saturated, and an increased intake of saturated fats can lead to high cholesterol. Respiratory problems too seem less common in vegetarians, but this is also the case with meat eaters who include a lot of fruit and vegetables in their diet. The UK Vegetarian Society's website quotes medical research has shown that on average, a lifelong vegetarian visits hospital 22% less than a meat eater. The fact that the number of practicing vegetarians has almost doubled in the last 15 years speaks volumes about the way our concerns for healthy living have changed. The reasons given for this increase have been, according to a recent survey, 94% due to the perceived health benefits associated with a vegetarian lifestyle. Doctors and nutritionists and responsible groups like the Vegetarian Society are rightly concerned that those adopting the vegetarian diet do so in an informed way. There are health benefits to be gained by turning vegetarian, but there are also guidelines that need to be followed. Vitamin B12, for instance, and recommended amounts of iron are not easily found in a vegetarian diet, and yet they are vital for healthy living. So, where can such vitamin and mineral replacements be found in the vegetarian diet? Well, for the average vegetarian, good sources of iron are spinach, prune juice, or dried fruit. Vegetarians are advised to eat these foods with fruit juices, which will increase the amount of iron absorbed. B12, on the other hand, is not as readily available, because it is only found, to all intents and purposes, in meat, fish, and dairy products. This vitamin is one which vegetarians find difficult to replace. However, as I said, low amounts of B12 can be found in dairy products as well as soy products or seaweed. For the stricter lacto-vegetarian and vegan, B12 can be obtained from foods that have been fortified with the vitamin. Vegetable margarines, some soy products, and breakfast cereals are the most common sources. The key to a healthy vegetarian diet is the same as any other diet. Eat a wide variety of foods, including grains, fruit and vegetables, beans, pulses and nuts. Vitamins and minerals must be included in the vegetarian diet, just as they have to be included in a non-vegetarian diet. You can argue all you like about vegetarians being healthier, but I'd suggest that you consider a well-balanced diet first and foremost. Whether or not you include meat is up to you. A good vegetarian diet closely matches the dietary recommendations for a healthy meat-eating diet. There's an excellent website which I suggest you look at if you want further information on vegetarianism. It's www.vegsoc.org. www.vegsoc.org.
That is the end of section 4 and the end of the listening test. You now have half a minute to check your answers.